Hello and welcome in, and joining us is the head coach of the Erie Tiger football team, Chad Cooper. And it's been quite the year. It still is quite the year.
Yes, it is. Yes.
But let's go back all the way to when this first started in March.
Yeah.
Obviously, you guys have spring practices and workouts. And what happened then, and how did that impact?
Yeah, so, you know, March probably sticks out in everyone's mind this year as kind of a transformational month from life being what we know as normal to being much different. Going back right before that, February, we had an event called The Arena. Basically, it was created by one of my assistants, Mike Rao. And Coach Rao had this idea, let's put them all in the big gym, let's do our maxes in there, kind of an event, and it went really, really great. I think it was the last week of February. And then the next week, literally, you know, everything started getting shut down. And into March and April is really when we start opening stuff up on the field, you know, doing our on-field stuff and stuff like that. And right away, I kind of had the thought that this might go on a little while. I didn't know, obviously, the impact it'd have. So we transitioned right away to at-home workouts, getting the kids as many resources as we could from home, because it wasn't going to be till June till we actually could see the kids again and in a limited capacity once we got. So, you know, that March, April, June was just May, June was just a really different time for everyone, and trying to give the kids resources to do stuff from home best we could. And a lot of kids really ran with it and did a really good job with it.
You talk about kids kind of running with it and doing a good job. Back in June, there was a lot of, this is what it's going to be. Okay, now it's going to change to this. Just a lot of changing going on. What did you guys kind of do as a program to fluctuate that and keep kids engaged and really keep them focused on improving and getting better?
Right. You know, when you're around kids every day and they're in the weight room and they're developing, you know, you look back and you're like, man, that kid really developed over the year. When kids came from first week of March till when we saw them in June, a couple of kids, I was like, oh my goodness. You could tell some of the kids were working really hard. And then once we were on the field, we had 135 kids program-wide show up that first week. And that was a clear message to me that, you know, we were going to have a really positive season, have a lot of investment by the kids first day, and kids were probably ready to do something normal. Because even though we were in small groups, we had limited groups, we had to be 6 feet away from each other, there was no equipment, there was masks on, we still had kids showing up every single day. And I think that was sent a message to me by our leadership and our kids that this is going to be a really good 2020 football-wise is going to be a good year.
One of the, I think, toughest things that you guys had to deal with is as you roll into August, we're still kind of waiting for the word from CHASA. And then ultimately we hear that there's not going to be football till the spring.
Right.
What was the morale of the team like? What was kind of your mindset? Just talk us through that period of time.
Yeah, we talked about adapting. I mean, I felt like, you know, good teams do that anyways, and we just try to prepare them. You know, we can't control what CHASA or the governor or the state of Colorado is going to dictate. We had been training and preparing like we're going to go in August, and then it didn't happen. And, you know, there's disappointment, obviously. I was disappointed, and I was more disappointed for my seniors than any other group because, you know, you kind of have, you know, the kind of have this anticipation for your senior year, and football really kind of kicks off your senior year in that type of way for all classes, but especially for seniors. But I think right away we kind of dialed back in and we were able to kind of refocus and get going again. And we were allowed to, again, work, at least be in the weight room and do some drills and stuff like that. And we did that. And then, obviously, there was a reverse course, and they told us within a matter of weeks that we were going to be back on the field.
Did you kind of see that coming and anticipate that there was going to be a reversal?
Yeah, I had some inside sources, you know, that give you some word that some stuff's going to happen, and, you know, not to go back and rehash it out, but it was like, oh, it's going to happen, then it might not, and it's going to happen, it might not. But, you know, at the end of the day, I felt like it was going to happen because there was so much pressure, and I think everyone felt like it was safe, that we could operate and have a football season safely, and I think that proved to be the case. You know, there were cancellation in games and stuff like that, but for the most part, I thought throughout the state, football is run in a safe manner and allowed to operate.
So when they did announced that they were going to give schools the option to either play in the shortened fall season or play in the shortened spring season. It seemed like most schools opted to play in the fall. Was there ever a question whether you would play fall or spring?
Yeah, there was zero doubt. I knew there was going to be a modification in terms of number of games. I knew we were only going to have like 2 weeks before our first game, literally 2 weeks. That's how long they gave us. But I felt like we were in a position to play, and I had talked to my seniors before if, you know, if this came up, what would you guys want to do? And it was a resounding let's play in the fall. And I think 80% of the teams, so most teams really wanted to play. And because of what we did before that, we were ready to go. So there was never doubt that we weren't going to play in the fall.
Well, then you finally got to the season.
Yeah.
And really got out of the gates strong.
Yeah.
That win against Greeley West.
Right.
First game in 4A. Obviously, the schedule's changing. The conference is even kind of maneuvering on the fly. Going up to 4A, did you see much of a difference in the jump from 3A to 4A?
Yeah, there's a difference. I think the biggest difference from the two classifications is depth. I think 3A to 4A, you have teams that are going to be very good teams in 3A. There's some really good competition in teams, and we saw that for the 4 years when I was here through all that. But I just think week in, week out, for the most part, you had good football teams that you're going to play. And, you know, we responded very well at the gate, you know, obviously against Greeley West and doing all that. But depth, as most teams are really well-run teams, and you're not, most of them are not going to be pushovers, and then depth within the teams itself. You have a kind of more rounded teams that are able to pass, throw, kind of do all that stuff and play good defense.
One moment that I really want to hear your insight on is you're playing Silver Creek.
Right.
It is raining ash on the field, and it's so smoky you can barely see across the other side of the field. And then the game gets paused. So you're in the middle of a pandemic.
Right.
You're in the middle of a smoke delay. Was there any point where you're like, what is happening?
I will always remember that game forever because I was standing on the sidelines before the game, and it was like it was snowing when it wasn't, and ash was falling down. And I knew there was a barometer they had, a meter that you read, and if it hits a certain mark, no matter what, you got to be off the field. And I was getting updates like after every possession. Hey, here's where we're at. And it was just climbing. And then finally they're like, hey, at halftime, we're going to cut this. And then 2 minutes later, they came back. We're pausing it right now. And I knew, I could feel it in my lungs.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously the most important thing was safety. I just didn't want the game to get canceled because we only had six, games at that point, from that point. And I knew how important wins were, too, for the playoffs. So I didn't want the game to get canceled. So we took our pause and we were able to get back after it. Luckily, whatever happened, wind, I don't know why it shifted, but we were able to resume. And then able to complete the game. So, yeah, it was a crazy story. And then after, I remember taking all my stuff off when I got home. It was like I was camping, you know, next to a campfire. I took it all off, and I smelled like fire. So I thought everyone handled it very, very well, from the players, coaches, and then the people running the game. The officials from St. Brand did a good job.
One of the things I was impressed with that kind of came out of that game was your guys' ability to utilize your depth and adjust. That's the game where Blake got hurt, and so you roll into a big opponent against Windsor.
Right.
You have to make some adjustments there, and that was a wild game in itself.
It was. You know, on top of rolling into 4A, we had some stuff that we changed. We changed components of our offense. We have a new defensive coordinator, whole new defensive kind of scheme. And without having, a summer to prepare for that and our normal stuff, we were kind of learning about ourselves on the fly. And I thought going into Windsor, that was going to be our first real true test, because Windsor historically is a really good 4A playoff team that's won state championships. And it was a great game. I think at times they exploited some stuff against us on defense. But again, we were learning. We were like putting guys in different spots on the fly that game and throughout the regular season. And then offensively, I thought – we really stepped up and did a great job. And everyone knew about Mason Vivi, but we were riding Mason Vivi, and he was almost able to deliver the win for us that game. And really sent a message, I think, to the state. I felt that, you know, Erie is going to be a good 4A football team.
You guys obviously dropped a tough one against Brighton.
Yeah.
And then I think, at least from my point of view, the game I was most excited about, the Broomfield game.
Right.
That gets the rug pulled out from under you last minute.
Yeah.
What was that like, telling your players, hey, I know it's 4 o'clock in the afternoon, but we're not going to be playing a game tonight?
Yeah, that was the toughest day I had in 2020. To be honest with you, I thought we were dealing with some players being quarantined with COVID, you know, and we had a week of practice, kind of adjusting players in different spots. I was excited about the plan that we have. I felt confident that the kids were ready. You know, you just get this feeling sometimes mentally when kids are dialed in, and I felt that week going into that game, we were really mentally dialed in and had a good plan. And then I got called to the office at 3 p.m., got told the news, and delivering that message to the team was hard, because I just knew, especially from the seniors who had been looking forward to this game, we kind of had circled Broomfield from the start of the season and the off season, that they would never get a shot at them again. So I felt it was tough, but with the way things turned out, getting an extra game, you know, that helped. But I'm sure, you know, that one's going to be tough for them, never to get a shot at Broomfield. But luckily, we'll get them for them next year.
You finish up the season against Bear Creek, a pretty good program. Played very well in that game. When you look back at that game, and then you look back at the season in its entirety, what does the Erie football program take away from this season that they can carry into next year?
Yeah, I feel like I said, we sent a strong statement to the state that we'll be in the mix for 4A playoffs and state championships for years to come. If there was a normal year and we had normal playoffs, we would have qualified for the playoffs and been in the mix. And then at that point, it's a second season, and who knows what's going to happen. We're also getting healthy at the end of the year. We got some players back. And it's a shame that they only had 8 teams in the playoffs instead of your normal 24 is what they actually do in 4A. So it was a disappointment that we couldn't have been in the playoffs and see. And that's the way we end our season. But, you know, having 6 all-conference first-team players, 3 of those being juniors, is a really good sign. I thought up front on offense, we're going to return 4 out of 5 players. Drake Rhodes was a great leader up front for us. And we already talked about Mason, the leadership that he showed. And then, you know, Jake Farling, and then a couple of guys on the back, Adam Bristow, just did a great job of kind of setting the tone for us in 4A for years to come.
Yeah, these seniors, they've been through a lot in this program. They've got to play in a state championship game. They've got to play with a really good class of kids in the past that have gone on and played college football. And now they're the first team in this program to play in 4A ball. What has this senior class meant to this program?
I think they taught us how to be resilient. Because like I said, some of the stuff I talked about, I don't think 135 kids are showing up that first day back without the senior class. I don't think we bounced back the way that we did after Brighton, you know, beating Heritage in the way that we did, where they had 3 Division I players, and beating that team without kind of the resilience that they showed. So, you know, in football, sports, and life, being resilient is something that you need to be, especially in 2020. I think people that have that character trait are able to handle everything that's thrown at them. And so I think that they taught, you know, not just the kids in the program, but us coaches, that being resilient is something that will reward you. And I really appreciative for all their efforts that they did for the program.
One thing I want to ask that I still have a hard time wrapping my head around.
Yeah.
In almost a little over half the games played, John Pastore blocks a record number of kicks.
He did.
Is that something you saw a lot in practice? Is that just...
Yeah.
How does that happen?
You know what? this had nothing to do with me. 0 to do with me. Sometimes you ask your coaches to, hey, here's a job I want you to do. You do it. Coach Vinny Pallone, it was his idea. He says, I got an idea how to block a kick. He showed it to me. I was like, go go for it and do it. And him and Keaton Dyson, them two basically were able to do this. So it wasn't just John blocking the kicks, but Keaton was able to basically take the blockers out of the way, and with John's kind of reach, he was able to block all those kicks. So a testament to, you know, Vinny, my other coach, is doing great things. There's a lot of other stories like that, but to set a state record in six games too, you know, is a really great story to take out of 2020.
Last question before we leave. Obviously, you'll take a lot from this year.
Yeah.
It's hard not to be excited
about
next year. What's kind of your message to the team as they approach off-season workouts and still what's a little bit uncertain time, but looking forward to next year?
Yeah, I mean, I think 2021 is not going to go back to the normal that we know of. We're still going to have to, you know, work out from home starting in 2021 probably. Doing some stuff's going to be a little bit different. You know, but I think, again, what the seniors did was teaching this future classes to put the work in before the season starts. And because they did that and we were prepared for those first two games, obviously we came out of the gates really quickly. And I think off-season development is a huge key, especially in 4A. You have to put work in the weight room and off-season drills and this and that and be prepared. And, you know, I'm not going to lie, I'm excited about the future. I think we got a hugely talented senior class coming up and, you know, some players, younger players beyond that are going to be super talented. Our JV only lost one game and our freshman only lost one game. So we had winning programs throughout and just super excited for the future and to compete in 4A.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much for joining us, Coach.
And I want to thank you, the voice of the Tigers, for helping us out, put this together. And Chad Jamison for helping us out. This is a cool deal that we're able to honor our seniors like this.
That's great. Well, thank you and best of luck going forward.
Thanks. Go Tigers.
Good evening, Erie football community. Coach Rao here to present the next certificate for our workout warrior. The game of football is the perfect example of a sport that you prepare for game night. You will never have fun at practice. Practice for football is grueling. You're getting hit, you're running scout reps, there's stop and start and talking. Football practice is rarely an enjoyable experience. Basketball, you get to practice in a climate controlled room. You get to scrimmage 2-on-2, 3-on-2, 5-on-5. Baseball, sunflower seeds, hanging in the sun, telling jokes with your boys. Football is a grueling grind that pays off on Friday nights. The other element of that goes unnoticed is the work that has to be put in the weight room. You cannot be successful in the game of football if you do not train at a high intensity. The Workout Warrior Award goes to recognize the guys that work above and beyond what we ask of them, but find a way to train, especially in a year like this pandemic. They have trained off-site, they have trained in their basements, they have worked at 1440. These guys, if you looked at them last year and you looked at them this season, noticeable difference in the makeup of their body comp and the way that they perform and play on the field. Bigger, faster, stronger, absolutely. It shows that in years past, we have only recognized one individual, but as this program has grown, we have pushed that level and we felt that this year we needed to recognize six individuals for the efforts in going above and beyond. Aiden Oxiger, John Pastor, Ryan McConnell, Braden Rao, Mason Vivi, Jake Farling. These guys give you what you need in the weight room as leadership and have set the foundation for younger Tigers going forward to see what you need to do. And you will see day by day, the small amounts of work you do culminate into a much larger successful plan for those gentlemen. All of them recognized in some capacity as all conference, all region, honorable mentions, some of them moving on to college. That is a foundation change in our program. Absolutely worth recognition. Congratulations to those six gentlemen. Thank you very much for what you've done.
What's up, guys? Before I announce my award winner tonight, I just want to congratulate everyone on a great season on all three levels. given the circumstances that we were under, we were really able to accomplish a lot. And so I'm really proud of everyone and how we were able to overcome a lot of obstacles this season. Tonight, I'm awarding the Future Impact Award winner. This award is presented to an individual who showed a high level of play as an underclassman. We had a student and player this year who showed a lot of growth and a lot of effort in as a player, but also as a leader in his class and on the team as a whole. And for that reason, this year, the Future Impact Award winner is Blake Barnett. So congratulations, Blake. We're really excited to see what you're able to do going forward with your remaining 3 years here at Erie and how you're able to develop as a player and a leader going on. So again, congratulations to all the winners and great job on a fantastic season, guys. Thanks.
I have the honor of presenting the 2020 PAW Award. The PAW Award is given annually to the individual who is recognized as an ideal teammate and exemplifies the characteristics of selfless play, commitment to team, and dedication. This year's winner has all the important characteristics of an ideal teammate. He is reliable, has a positive attitude, empathetic, adaptable, and persistent. While he wasn't a starter at the start of the season, by demonstrating reliability, positive attitude, and persistence, he became a starter as the season progressed. I don't think I ever heard this player complain about anything throughout the course of the season. The COVID restrictions, the weather, his playing time, being asked to play on special teams, or anything. When given the opportunity to start on defense this year, this player rose to the occasion and became a key contributor at linebacker. It is my distinct pleasure to present the 2020 PAW Award to Jacob Flood. Congratulations, Jacob.
Hello, Erie Football. I'm going to talk about the Special Teams Player of the Year. This was an especially tough one to give out, considering we had two individuals, one that seemed to score every time he touched the ball, and one that seemed to block a kick every time he was on the play. First of all, congratulations, John Pastor, on setting the state record for blocked kicks in half a dang season. With that being said, your 2020 Special Teams Player of the Year is Mason Vivi. He averaged the most yards per touch on a kick return in the state of Colorado, all classifications, and if he hadn't got hurt, he probably would have scored three or four more. Congratulations, Mason. You kicked butt on that. Coach Delp, great job with that unit. I look forward to somebody stepping into Mason's place next year and trying to be half as good as him. Because if you're half as good as Mason on kick returns, you might win Special Teams Player of the Year too. Again, congrats to John Pastor and Keaton. We know how much work you do on that unit, setting the state record for block kicks. But Mason, this award is all yours and you are well deserving. Any team in the state of Colorado would have been more than honored to have you on their team returning kicks.
This is Coach Higgins, and this year I am proud to present the Iron Tiger Award. Winners of this award exemplify dependability and display resilience, persistence, and leadership. If there was ever a time when these qualities were in need, it was this year. I can't think of any acknowledgement that could be more meaningful in the face of adversity than the steadfast accountability that this award is meant to represent. I'm proud to recognize Junior Ryan McConnell as the 2020 winner of the Iron Tiger Award. Ryan shows up every day and does whatever is asked. He never has anything but encouragement for his teammates, and on top of all that, is one of the best, most prepared, and most ready players we have had the pleasure to coach. Congratulations, and thank you for your example and your leadership, Ryan.
Hello, Coach Martinez here, and I am honored to present the Civitas Award. Civitas. Erie High School football defines the word Civitas as the person that represents himself, his teammates, and EHS in the community. I've coached this young man for the past 4 years, and not only does he have the characteristics that define the word Civitas on the field, but more importantly, off the field. I seriously doubt anyone in Erie could find anything negative to say about this young man. I believe his teammates would agree with me when I say that he does everything he can for his team 100% of the time. Whether that is pushing his teammates to their limits while also pushing himself, playing both offense and defense, and then always being willing to play scout team whenever he wasn't in. He never complained, ever. He led and continues to lead by example. He said he could, and against Bear Creek, did play almost every position on the field. He also wrestles for the Tigers, and I can't wait to see what he does on the mat. He is one of the most respectful people I have been around. It has been a privilege and an honor to spend this time with him. He bleeds black and orange, a true competitor, the winner of the EHS Football Civitas Award, Mr. Gus Fonseca Walker. Congratulations.
I'm Adam Bristow. We had a great season, and I'm handing this jersey down to Mason Cowgill.
Hi, it's Jake Farling. I wanted to say a special thank you to my coaches and everyone involved with the program, especially also my family. I love you guys. I tore my meniscus this year, and it was fun to have the support of my coaches. They helped me through all the battles of this season. I appreciate it. And yeah, I'm looking forward to the future. I'm giving number 22 to Sean Thomas. I hope he has a good season and that he reps the 2-2s. Thank you.
I'm Jacob Flood. I just want to thank my mom, my dad, and all the coaches for this year. They made it the best as it could be in 2020, which was a bad year. And I'm giving my number to Jace Onstead.
Hi, I'm Gus Fonseca Walker. I'm very thankful for the season and the fact that we got to even have our 6 games that we got in. And I'll be giving number 3 to Blake Barnett. He's worn number 3 his whole life, so hopefully he'll be able to wear it.
Hi, my name is Jaden George, and I'd like to first off thank all my family members, teachers, coaches, and everyone who's really helped me out in life get to where to the point I am here today. And for our first year in 4A, I feel like we did really good. We have a lot of potential on our team. And with that being said, I'd like to give number 10 to Dominic Atatavia.
My name is Jasper Hansen, and this year was my senior year. I played as number 53. The number is going to my brother, Carson Hansen, and he'll be playing his junior year. Probably the highlight of the year was that I was able to play my first year of football. I would like to say thank you to the coaching staff and thank you to an amazing group of players that we had this year on the varsity law roster.
Hi, I'm Benji Havener, and I just want to say I'm thankful for all my coaches for giving me the opportunity to play again. They accepted me back with open arms after I moved away. And I'm super thankful for them not giving up on me. And last but not least, I want to thank my temporary family I'm living with right now for homing me. That's very nice of them. And I'll be giving my jersey to Cohen Nazary, 13 baby.
I'm Brendan Murphy. The season's been a tough one for a lot of us, but we made it. It was a good season. I'm going to be giving my jersey, number 6, to Kyle Ladley.
Hi, my name is Andrew Piper, and I played slot receiver, free safety, and outside linebacker for Erie High School. Erie High School has done so much for me in terms of guiding me through my life. The last 4 years have been great. Huge thank you to all my family and all my coaches. Everybody on this team has done so much for me, and I thank them very much for these 4 years. I'll be giving my jersey number to Caleb Deason, number 8. I hope you do well. Don't mess it up.
I want to start off by saying thank you to all my coaches and family. They've been there for a long time, for 4 years, and some for more, and I want to thank them for that and being by my side through everything. They've really helped me get through this and helped me
push myself to be my best self and best self I can be for the team. I wanna give a huge thanks to all the other moms that have been there since day one. Some of them have been like a second mom to me since I was 8. I wanna say thank you to them personally, and of course all the fathers too. So yeah, just thank you to everyone who supported myself and the team and my boys. I love y'all, I love the coaches, I love the families. Thank you guys. And I'm gonna pass my number down to my little brother, Logan. I think he'll be able to keep the number 12 going.
My name is Drake Rhodes, and I wanna thank all the coaches and parents for making this year possible through all the hard times we faced this year. And I'm gonna be passing my number down to Christian Shattuck.
Hey, what's up? It's Braden Ralph. Most of you know me. I want to start this off by saying how extremely thankful for not only Chad Cooper, but the entire Erie football staff I am. The things that you guys have done for me over the last 4 years is, you can't put words to it. Just some of the things are just insane. As a little freshman, you always told me, like, keep working, and then for all we know, junior I played, senior you helped me out immensely with recruiting. I just want to say thank you. Secondly, I want to say how extremely thankful for Miss Tanessa and Mr. Carpenter I am. I know that you guys have done a lot for the football program, and not only the football program, but me. I've come to talk to you guys about a lot of things, and you've always been there for me. And lastly, I want to say how thankful for my dad I am. It's been 12 years, man. I remember you coaching me and flag football, and now we're here. I'm a senior. I'm graduating. It's crazy. Look at all the times the juice is screaming at me, and I'm here. We made it. Oh, lettuce. Take good care of your team for me, please.
My name's Mason Beebe. I played running back for Erie High School, and first I'm going to start by thanking all the coaches who have coached me from when I was 7. Big shout out to Jacoby Swenson, who coached me until I was a freshman in high school. Love the man. He's one of the father figures in my life. He's been great. Big thanks to obviously all of the Erie High School coaches, the Chambers family and Conalog at the freshman level, all the way up to Coach K and the Delps at the JV level, and then the varsity coaches. Big thank you to all of you, my family, especially my mom and dad and sisters for always supporting me. With that being said, Erie High School was some of the best 4 years of my life, and I'm gonna be giving number 7 to Luke Furman. His older brother gave it to me, and it was an honor to receive that, and I hope that me giving it to him honors him, and I know that he's gonna do great things.
Hello, I'm Forrest Wilson. I would like to thank both my parents and my grandparents for this game. For this season. I would also love to thank my uncle because he's the one who actually got me to play football. He's a coach down in Fort Collins, and I started training with him and everything, so he's one of the biggest reasons why I was a football player. I'm going to thank my parents and grandparents because I came to all my games and supported me, and I'd also like to pass down my jersey down to Chase Miller, number 46.
crew. Silent love's calling faith to shadow me through your hallways. New echoes you can feel and rehearse the way you need.
I've been hearing symphonies before all I heard was silence.
Summertime sadness.
When the days are cold and the cards all fold, and the saints we see are all made of gold.
if every day goes like this, how do we survive?
Let's make this fleeting moment last forever.